Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining BGP Route Reflectors. If you find this video informative, don't forget to click that thumbs up button. And if you find the content useful, make sure to subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. Now, in a previous video, I talked about iBGP's full mesh peering requirement, where all iBGP routers within an AS must peer with every other iBGP router in that AS. Otherwise, iBGP will not function correctly. In that video, we saw that this requirement has a scalability problem. As the number of iBGP routers in the AS grows, the number of iBGP peerings you must create increases exponentially, drastically limiting the size of an AS. Now, route reflectors are used to alleviate this limitation. Now, a route reflector is a BGP router that has been configured to act as a centralized hub which collects and redistributes or reflects routing information among other iBGP routers in the same autonomous system without requiring them to maintain that full mesh of peerings to each other. So essentially, it's a method of overcoming or bypassing that full mesh rule. For those of you that have studied OSPF, a route reflector is something similar in logic to a designated router or a DR for a particular network segment. The idea is similar, but the implementation is quite different. Now, when deploying an iBGP route reflector, we must become aware of the various roles that iBGP routers play within an AS. Now, there's the role of the route reflector itself, which is the router we choose to play that centralized role. Then there is the route reflector client. These are the iBGP routers that are configured to peer with the route reflector directly. Route reflector clients don't need to establish iBGP peerings with each other, and this is the fundamental benefit that route reflectors deliver. And finally, there are non-client iBGP peers, which are those routers that have not been configured as an RR or an RR client. Now, a route reflector can have three types of peerings: a peering with an eBGP router that exists in another AS, a peering with an iBGP route reflector client neighbor, or a peering with an iBGP non-client neighbor. Now, it's important to understand the roles and the types of peerings that a route reflector can have in order to start discussing how iBGP route reflectors function. Now, in the topology we see here, we can see that the RR has a single eBGP peering with this router here, which is in AS200. Now, within its home AS of 100, we see four client routers. So there are four peerings here, from the RR to each of the client routers. Now, for the RRs and the RR clients, the full mesh iBGP peerings do not apply. We have bypassed this requirement, and each client needs only to create a peering with the route reflector. So by definition, client routers must not have iBGP peerings between them. Now, we also have two non-client routers here. These are the routers that haven't been configured as either route reflector clients or route reflectors themselves. Now, it may seem strange to have these here. Why not configure them as client routers as well? Well, it's not required, and having them as part of an AS is a legitimate network architecture. And there are reasons why you would do this. The important thing here, however, is to understand how these specific iBGP routers behave. For these routers, the full mesh iBGP peerings is still a requirement, and they will see the route reflector and the route reflector clients as simply normal iBGP routers with which they peer. Now, we've seen what kind of peerings take place when we have a route reflector and route reflector clients and non-client routers as well. Now we have to understand how routes are exchanged and forwarded between all of these routers. Now, an RR follows a set of rules. First of all, a route learned from a non-client is advertised or reflected to all Route Reflector clients, but not to other non-clients. A route learned from a Route Reflector client is advertised to both Route Reflector clients and non-clients. And finally, a route learned from an eBGP neighbor is advertised to both Route Reflector clients and non-clients. Now, this may sound like gibberish initially. It sounds strange. We might not be able to visualize this, but in order to understand these rules better, let's see what they actually look like on the diagram itself. So let's say the 30.30.30.0/24 network is advertised from this router to the Route Reflector. Remember, this non-client router has iBGP peerings with all other routers in the AS. So the Route Reflector receives this route. The Route Reflector will advertise or reflect the 30.30.30.0/24 route to its RR clients, but not to the other non-client here. If it did that, it would violate the split horizon rule. Client routers and Route Reflectors are exempt from the split horizon rule, but non-clients are not. So this rule is still enforced when it comes to the non-clients. I have a video about the iBGP split horizon rule if you want to learn more about that in the description below. Now the next rule says that a route learned from an RR client is advertised to both RR clients and non-clients. So here, the 20.20.20.0/24 network that this client router has advertised to the Route Reflector is then re-advertised or reflected to client routers, as well as to non-client routers. So essentially, the RR will reflect such a route to everyone in the AS. Now, it's interesting to note here that even the RR client that originally advertised the route will receive a copy, but it will discard it because it sees itself as the originator. Now, finally, if the Route Reflector learns a route from its eBGP neighbor here in AS200, then that route will be advertised to both Route Reflector clients and non-clients. Once again, in this scenario, all iBGP routers within the AS will receive such an advertisement. Now, there are some things to keep in mind when configuring Route Reflectors. Unlike OSPF, where the DR and BDR elections take place automatically, the Route Reflector configurations must be applied manually. That means that you must decide beforehand which router will be the Route Reflector and which routers will be the client routers for that RR, and then go in and configure all of these things manually. Secondly, it is possible to create multiple Route Reflectors within an AS for redundancy. You can configure iBGP routers to become clients of multiple Route Reflectors. And such an approach is important to employ redundancy and load balancing of route management. And finally, because Route Reflectors by definition violate the split horizon rule, which is used for loop prevention, we need another mechanism to ensure that our iBGP topology is loop free. And two important pieces of information that are shared between Route Reflectors and their clients are the originator ID and the cluster list. These are used in order to prevent routing loops. I will create a video about these particular pieces of information, but for now, just know that they are used to eliminate routing loops. So that's the gist of iBGP Route Reflectors, how they work and what they are used for. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.